Every time we let hate flourish.
Team Biden teams up with a hate group to root out America's hate groups. Forget the peasants in the hood. While your cities are burning and your children are getting shot in the street, the political elite in Washington, D.C. are still freaking out over this guy. Shocking new video tells the rest of the story. Plus, some good news. Mask mandates are lifted, but even the Department of Justice is not requiring proof of vaccination in order to ditch the masks. Apostate Catholic, pro-abortion, climate change hysteric, John Kerry meets with Pope Francis. Question, is Remnant TV becoming too political? All that and more tonight from the editor's desk. Hello again, ladies and gentlemen. Michael Mack coming to you once again from the offices of the Remnant newspaper. Hello, welcome. Whether you're watching us on RemnantTV.com or YouTube or what do we got now? Spotify, whatever. You know, listening to a podcast in your car right now.
All the podcast places.
That's it. All the podcast places. Thank you so much for joining us, for being with us. Welcome. Don't forget to like and share, I think I'm supposed to say. So, the news. The news of the day is interesting. It's all over the place right now. Uncle Joe, his handlers now have him out there signing hate crime bills.
That all men and women are created equal, endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights, including life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Every time we're silent, every time we let hate flourish, we make a lie of who we are as a nation.
Well played, sir.
And true to form, Joe Biden is working with leftist hate groups to track down the Trump to track down the hate groups. Yes, he is. He's working with the Southern Poverty Law Center. The two experts in countering extremism are top dogs at the Southern Poverty Law Center. You know, these guys.
The Southern Poverty Law Center, based in that building in Alabama, calls itself the premier group monitoring hate groups. But what donors don't know is that today the center smears people who don't deserve to be smeared. The center also calls the Family Research Council a hate group. But once you're labeled a hate group, you become a target.
Developing now, word of a shooting at the Family Research Council there in Washington.
One man was so enraged by what the center said about the Family Research Council, he went to their headquarters to kill people.
Now, we all know the Southern Poverty Law Center, where our friends over there are special. Special indeed. They've been after us for years. Basically, they're a bunch of racist bullies that raise a lot of money scaring the heck out of people. And they've been after the Remnant for, well, I don't know what, since 2007, I think.
Yeah,
I think it's when they first started coming after us. They put us on their hate map. We should throw that thing back up on the screen. If you look up there, see the state of Minnesota. You see that little dot right there? Guess what? Ba-da-ba-da-bum! That's us! We've been occupying that position of honor for a long time. The wall of honor, I call it. The map of honor. And, of course, we've been using that designation from the SPLC for promotional purposes for years. So whatever you do, Southern Poverty Law Center, don't take us off the hate mat. It has been very good for our fundraising efforts over the years. Appreciate it very much. Basically, now, if you're not on the Southern Poverty Law Center's hate map, as we are, along with Family Research Council and dozens of other pro-life, pro-family groups, well, the chances are you need to get busy. You need to work a little harder, track their attention, because they... Once you get there, you know you've arrived. You're doing some good when the SPLC comes down. So now they're teaming up with Biden. It's just fantastic. You know, these characters didn't... I mean, I don't expect them to crack any books, but you would have thought some of these people would have at least watched some movies, you know, about the Nazi era or the Soviet era, you know, the Stasi, the KGB, the Gestapo. These guys are getting set to do it all over again. And under the pretext of fighting hate, you know, they're actually promoting hate, which is why now they need to transform January 6th, what they call 1-6, to kind of get into that 9/11 thing, 1-6. They need to transform 1-6 into what it, not what it actually was, but what they say it was. They don't want anything to do with what it actually was, because what it really was, as I pointed out at the time, in my opinion, was a ridiculous setup that should never have happened and did a lot of damage to Donald Trump because some characters got carried away. We all saw the video. You know what happened. We're going to talk about it in a minute, but you know what happened there. Some kids got out of control, and their entrance into the Capitol, at least on certain sides of the Capitol building, was very suspicious. I've never seen police behave like that, and I used to be in law enforcement. I can't imagine what the cops were thinking. Please, if you could just be honest about what this is all about. You know what it's all about, what's happening right now. The way they exploited what happened, and let me be clear, what happened was a dumpster fire. It was a tragedy. It was a crisis. To me, it looked like a setup, in fact. I didn't go to that thing because I didn't believe in whatever that was going on. My impression was that Donald Trump was being set up. And of course, we ran that video of the young man. I wasn't that young. Man standing out in front of the Capitol, screaming at the Capitol police. Why are you doing this? Stop this. This is our Capitol.
Why haven't you called for backup? Where is your backup? This is our damn Capitol building. And y'all are letting it get destroyed on your watch.
Now, not a whole lot happened except a bunch of hooligans did some stupid stuff and one poor girl got gunned down by a trigger-happy Capitol cop, and that was about it. And of course, she was a Trump voter. So this is going to be something of a challenge for Chuck and Nancy. And never mind that this is what actually happened.
The police here are willing to work with us and cooperate peacefully, like our First Amendment allows. Gather more Americans under the condition that they will come and gather peacefully to discuss what needs to be done to save our country. We're going to be heard. Everybody, this must be peaceful.
This has to be peaceful. We have the right to peacefully assemble.
So there's no surprise there. But why isn't this clip all over social media? You know how I got it? Somebody put it up on Facebook and it immediately violated the community standards and was taken right down because it throws a wrench into Chuck and Nancy's narrative here. It stands in the way of the push to turn this nothing burger thing with the stupid guy with the horns, to turn that into a whopper by drumming up enough hate and enough fear for the baby killers then to keep the House in 2022, maybe even win 2024, despite this dumpster fire that is President Joe Biden. But the thing is, and I want to talk about some good news tonight. The thing is, not all is well in Team Biden camp. I'm sure you've noticed this. The wheels are coming off COVID right now, prematurely. And I remember just wasn't a few weeks ago, Uncle Joe was out there blasting Texas as Neanderthal for calling Barbara Streisand on the COVID cult. Remember?
I think it's a big mistake. The last thing we need is the Neanderthal thinking that in the meantime, everything's fine. Take off your mask. Forget it. It still matters.
Things are falling off. The wheels are coming off this thing. It doesn't mean, again, that they're not going to come up with something else. COVID-21, whatever it might be. Climate change lockdowns. I don't know. But right now, things are falling apart. This is good news. Enough people got up in their grill, and now it's falling apart. So we need to keep that up. We need to keep the pressure up. I don't know. What do you think? Are they going to get away with vaccination passports?
I don't think so. The American frontline doctors actually are suing HHS right now over vaccines for kids.
This happened today?
Yeah, it just happened today.
Wow, okay. America's Frontline Doctors, that's Dr. Gold, another hater, of course, suing HHS. This is great. I mean, why wouldn't they? I mean, the fact that they are requiring children to take a vaccination that is not even approved yet for a virus that does them virtually no harm whatsoever, literally making children guinea pigs now. This is just insane. I mean, it is insane. So maybe some of these lawsuits are going to work in a stick. Let's hope that happens anyway. Because I don't think they're going to be able to pull this thing off. Even the Department of Justice now won't be asking their employees, federal employees, for their vaccination status after going maskless. Just last Friday, the DOJ released a memo warning managers and their departments not to ask whether employees have been vaccinated. This is really good news. Because if federal departments and agencies are not able to pull off vaccination passports, I wonder how long this is going to last. And the thing is, if they don't do it quickly, if this just kind of happens now, the masks are off all over the place. We're in bluest of blue, Minnesota, the state where nothing is allowed. Masks are gone in a lot of the big stores, Lowe's, Walmart, Target, gone right now. So now Nancy Pelosi is out there right now trying to maintain the maskocracy. But even that, not going too well for her.
Well, we would just like to abide by the science. What's interesting is you look at this building, there's a chamber for the House and a chamber for the Senate. But apparently, COVID works differently in both chambers. Because in the Senate, you don't wear a mask. In the House, you have to wear a mask. The only difference is the Speaker. She doesn't want to abide by the CDC rules. She actually wants to have greater control. That, to me, is a real frustration on all that we have happened. How can the Senate not wear a mask and the House in the same building?
And again, Target store. I've been boycotting Target for how long. We started boycotting it over the bathroom. I haven't been inside a Target in years. But Target stores lifting their masks and not requiring proof of vaccination. This is interesting. It's significant. You know what it might be? More good news. Hell is chaotic, isn't it? And these people are little demons out of hell. They're mixed up. They're turning on each other constantly. It's not going to go smoothly, friends. And we're going to talk a lot about that tonight. The idea that we can fight back and that we need to. You know, you look at Pope Fauci now. He's out there on Saturday Night Live getting mocked. That's significant, you know? And at the same time, you know, Fauci is routinely being exposed as a fraud, not only on, you know, Fox News, but also in the chambers of government in Washington, D.C.
Is the United States funding gain-of-function research?
Not to my knowledge.
Okay. Can you give an answer to that for me and let us know what the committee know?
Dr. Fauci would be the one who knows best, and he testified last
week. Dr. Fauci seems confused. I'm asking, with all due respect, I'm asking you to get us that information.
Maybe it's because Dr. Fauci, the all-knowing Dr. Fauci, who Mr. Rogan in his piece said has, quote, repeatedly thrown cold water on the lab leak theory, maybe Dr. Fauci would have to answer some tough questions if we actually dug into how this thing started.
Tony Fauci is punishing the country, you, us, everyone. The question is, why is he doing that? Maybe he likes it, that's possible. But you've got to think that at least part of Tony Fauci's authoritarian germ hysteria is a cover for something else. Could it be that Tony Fauci is trying to divert attention from himself and his own personal role in the COVID-19 pandemic?
And meanwhile, as we touched on last time, and this is just unfolding, now here's the thing about this. Amidst, you know, mounting concerns over the safety, vaccination safety, the side effects of vaccine, everything else, mounting deaths, what did I hear, 4,500 dead, that's a high number that are supposedly allegedly connected to the vaccine. They got problems with this vaccine. And one gets the impression there are people who are not necessarily interested in going down with that ship. Bill Gates, now suddenly tied to a sex trafficker, Jeffrey Epstein. This is huge, friends. And we can come up with all sorts of conspiracies. Oh, they're just reallocating funds. They're just reorganizing the Gates Foundation. Well, maybe that's true, but maybe it's not. You know, the reality is right now what we know for sure, the guy behind, principally behind Agenda 2030, the guy behind the Sustainable Development Goals, even the Great Reset to a significant extent, Bill Gates, humiliated as a liar and a philanderer in all of this. Folks, I'm always saying, you know, we got to pray that something happened, pray that God intervenes. And then God may be intervening right now. We're saying, nah, it's part of the conspiracy. It's not happening. Don't fall for it. Well, I'm glad I'm not Bill Gates right now. This is one unhappy cat. No matter what happens, total humiliation for Bill Gates. This is good news, friends. Because if the high priest of climate change, if he can't be trusted even by his own wife, who's going to trust him on anything else? Who's going to trust him when it comes to getting rid of hamburgers and cows and shooting dust particles up at the sun to save the planet? When he tells us this is really necessary, you're going to believe him? When he's like, even his own people at Microsoft, people in his own good companies and corporations will say this guy's all over the place chasing the ladies around, hanging out with Epstein. He can't be trusted. He's lying to his wife. Come on, man. You actually think this is part of the conspiracy? Because I don't. When we can find some good news To keep everybody in the game, we have to talk about it. Now, I'm not suggesting that even if Bill Gates continues this slide and completely crashes and burns, I'm not suggesting it's the end of the war. Obviously, there's a lot of more powerful people. I don't trust the lovely Mrs. Gates farther than I can throw her. An apostate, pro-abort Catholic, she's horrific. But I like the division. I like the division, as Abraham Lincoln said, a house divided can't stand, right? I like this. This is an opportunity. Not the end of the war, but it's an opportunity we need to exploit. Because you know what? We've got fear pimps on our side, too. And I hope I don't get in trouble for talking about this a little bit, but I'm going to talk about it a little bit. I see it on the blogosphere. I see it all over social media. I see it in my email box. Folks on our side sometimes seem to be doing the same thing that the folks on the left are trying to do. They're using fear tactics to promote despair and inaction, to promote the idea that resistance is futile. I'm a positive guy by nature, so I run into this all the time. What are you doing, Michael Matt? Why are you saying this is positive? This isn't positive. This is negative. It's always, always negative. Yeah, there's a lot of negative out there. But right now, there are some fantastic signs. So if all you're getting on your feed and thread is just, it's the end of the world, we can't possibly fight this, we're going to die, I would suggest move away from that. We need to stay up for the fight. Henry V stands what? He stands before his men on St. Crispin's Day, right? And famously telling them that they're going to beat the impossible odds, right? That they're going to win. That's what he did. Now, can you imagine if Henry V has stood up there, as some bloggers are doing today, and he says, nobody's going to outlive this day. Nobody's going home safe today. This day, we are outnumbered. We can't possibly win. But we can pray, and we can hope for a miracle, boys. What? Are you kidding me? We can pray? Well, there you go. Pray, very old one. Pray like the wind, because Henry thinks that's all we got left. This is not a good way to fight a war. In fact, it's an excellent way to lose the war. It'd be like William Wallace at the Battle of Stirling Bridge. They will take our lives, and they already have taken our freedom. What are we going to do? We're going to lose, guys, you know? Really? In fact, that sort of happens in the film for a few moments. Remember this?
Will you fight? Against that? No! We will run! And we will live!
Who wants to be those two clowns? You know, we're gonna run! Really? And yet I see this all the time out there in the blogs. I'm gonna die, man! What if God doesn't exist? What are we gonna do? I don't think I can stay in the Catholic Church. I gotta join the Orthodox. This is all over. Where is the precedent for any of that? And the great stories of valor and heroism, the great men of Christendom, what's wrong with us? And history will tell the story of Don John of Austria freaking out on the poop over the Holy League, saying, men of Christendom, stay home! Avoid the Gulf of Lepanto like the flipping plague. Ali Pasha, dude, he's like the devil incarnate. Too many Turks! Stay home, men of Christendom, and pray. What? Why do we bother telling these stories? If when we get on hard times like we are right now, we fold up like a cheap suit. And I guess, friends, and this is where I'm going to get a little, probably in a little trouble if I'm not already, I'm kind of tired of people, caps, locking me to death, telling me, you know, that the troops, telling the troops on our side that we're just going to die. So fall back because we can't win. I know this because I had a dream and the Lord told me it's all over. It's the end of the world. Really? That sounds like a personal problem. Don John of Austria, friends, was totally outnumbered by the Ottoman Turks, as was Pelayo by the Moors in Spain. The Vendeans in France, how many times have we told the story? Totally outnumbered. Places like Nantes, Battle of Nantes. The Cristeros in Mexico. The English at Agincourt. Outnumbered. Pick your favorite tilt in history, and the good guys were outnumbered. So, today we're outnumbered too. And so what? What of it? Let's look for the advantage. Let's look for the opportunity. Look for the crack in the flank. Look for the opportunity to strike. We jumped on the opportunity that was Donald Trump, didn't we? We jumped on them immediately in 2015. Not because he was a saint, but because the man wanted to fight. And he wanted to fight the same enemies of Christian patriots that we've been fighting for 50 years. And what did we hear from the holy people online? He's an adulterer. He says swear words. We mustn't support him. I'm not used to a battle or an army that's being led by school marms like that. In 2015, I wasn't looking for a saint. I was looking for a fighter, weren't you? And that's what Trump is, what he turned out to be, obviously. And that's why the anti-Christians right now are still freaking out and trying to take him down, because he fought them. And in the process, he became more Christian than he had ever been before. Speaking the name of Jesus Christ many, many times, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You remember?
This is a holy season, the celebration of the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The Christmas story begins 2,000 years ago with a mother, a father, their baby son, and the most extraordinary gift of all, the gift of God's love for all of humanity.
We got to keep scanning the horizon. Yes, we're outnumbered. Yes, it's scary. Yes, we're up against big, powerful, well-trained, well-heeled, evil troops. Doesn't change a thing. We got to keep scanning the horizon for the next opportunity, for the next David that God will raise up against the Goliath of the New World Order. And people say, yeah, well, the remnant is losing focus, man. Too much politics, not enough talk about prayer, too much Fox News. Stop it. Man, speaking for myself, I come from a long line of Catholic journalists, not Catholic priests. I'm not your priest. I'm not your mother. You see? And my family has been in the Catholic press apostolate for 155 years, fighting the political foes of Christ the King, the political enemies of Christendom, Freemasons, and the other godless children of darkness who were engaged in the field of politics to take down the cross. Are you going to sit that one out? You want us to sit this one out and sit around and tell you to pray, something you should be doing every day anyway by now? That's not my job. We're not going to sit this one out and let these demons destroy our homeland. As I say, we're not cutting the rosary out either. It's wrapped around the hilts of our swords. And we're not, by the way. I hear this sometimes. As long as we're talking about this, I might as well just dive right in. We're not toddling after Fox News. They're actually the ones that are catching up with us. You see, because traditional Catholics who spent the past half century fighting the roots of the revolution that's now tearing the world apart, you see, we're always looking for allies. We're not looking for saints necessarily. We're waiting for God to raise the saint up. But in the meantime, we're looking for allies. And allies are to be found in some very strange places right now. The pioneer traditional Catholics called what's going on right now, they called it the one world government. They warned against it. That was what the whole social doctrine, the kingship of Christ, was all about. That's why the Second Vatican Council doesn't even mention the kingship of Christ, because it was setting up for a world that would not have the church standing in the way of a one world government. Guys like Michael Davies, Walter Matt, Archbishop Lefebvre, they were political. They were warning against what they called the one world government, which included a one world church. We call it the New World Order, because that's the new term. But it's the same exact thing. Everything going on right now, friends, was predicted. I'm not boasting or tooting my own horn, but we need to get this right, what our role is in all of this. We have to bring the conservative Catholic, Christian, traditional Catholic force onto the field and be effective. We've got so much to offer. We have the ultimate truth. We do connect the dots between what's happening politically right now and the war on Jesus Christ. We have to be a part, an active part of this army. And everything going on right now, which is why I say this, was predicted, is in the pages of The Remnant, our family newspaper. 50 years ago, we've got an archive. You can sign up for it and check it out if you want. 50 years ago. Why? Because the New World Order is a replacement religion for Christianity. The Great Reset is a deposit of faith now. Climate change hysteria, it's a set of dogmas that you must accept under pain of mortal sin against Pachamama, Mother Earth, the new god. You see? Humanism, pantheism, the gods of the new age, Gaia. Dr. Fauci, Klaus Schwab, we have a lot of fun with this guy, but what is he? He's the high priest of a new religion. Fauci, Schwab, George Soros, Bill Gates, the rest of them, high priests of a new religion. And all they needed, friends, sadly and tragically for those of us who are Catholic to see, all they needed was a pope, and they got one. They snuck one in. They got one over the wall, one of theirs. And that's why we're opposing Francis as well, because he's trying to hand what's left of the Catholic Church, the human element of the Catholic Church, over to the defenders of this new religion, the priests of this new religion. Since 1965 now, and much before too, but as far as traditional Catholics are concerned, since 1965, I've been fighting these forces. These forces which have been working to dismantle the old Christian order with its universal liturgy. This is the whole thing about the Latin Mass. I'm sorry if I'm speaking over the heads of some of the Protestant friends out there who watch this show. But the Latin liturgy united the entire Catholic world. Billions of Catholics worldwide going to the exact same liturgy. That was a powerful block they had to get out of the way. The hospitals. You know who started hospitals? We'll do a show on this one time. The Catholic Church, the monasteries, started hospitals. So we even had our whole system of hospitals throughout the whole world, Catholic Church. I was born in St. Joe's Hospital. We had St. Luke's Hospital, St. John's Hospital here in St. Paul. Most of them now have changed because the Catholic Church choked, gave it all up. Hospitals, schools, universities, Catholic parishes throughout every city in the Western world. That was a powerful thing. Now, you don't have to be a Catholic to see that if you're trying to do world domination, you'd better get rid of the strongest and largest denomination of Christianity in the world. That's exactly what they did. And you don't think this is our fight? They had to get rid of the old world order based on Christ, who we purport to follow, so that they could set up a new world order based on Antichrist. And this is a war for Fox News? They're the ones who are supposed to fight this, not us? We're going to stay in our basement and say our prayers? Really? Fox News is going to take care of this? Are you kidding me? Think about this. We saw Sean Hannity interviewing Caitlyn Jenner the other night. So obviously, for a whole hour, Hannity interviewed him. For all the good that they do, especially guys like Tucker Carlson, I got a ton of respect for that guy. A lot of respect for Laura Ingraham. Fox certainly has not connected the dots from what's going on today back to the old war against the kingship of Jesus Christ. They don't. They stop short every time. Guess what? That's our job. Work with Fox as far as exposing the bad guys and the Great Reset and Schwab and Gates and all these other people, Biden, Nancy Pelosi, everybody. And then we do our job, which is the most important, the job of proclaiming the kingship of Christ. And again, people don't like to hear this. Well, I don't know, Fox News is terrible. Laura Ingraham, man, she's got a brother who's gay. I remember hearing this. Remember hearing this? Like, we can't take her seriously because she's got a homosexual brother. Well, then nobody bothered to check into that. This brother of hers is a homosexual who hates her, despises Laura Ingraham, who's a Catholic convert, right on his Twitter feed. What does it say? Something like, sibling fact checker is how he describes himself. You got to put this stuff in perspective, friends. We do have allies. We people who know the Catholic Church right now is in huge trouble. Catholics like Laura Ingraham, they know something's really, really wrong in the Vatican right now, which means there's a tremendous amount of progress from when I was a kid and everybody thought the popes were perfect and couldn't sin and they were just absolutely inspired by God every time they burped, right? Those days are gone, thanks to Francis. And the reality is that when Pope Paul VI took off his crown, we've showed that video many times, he put the whole world on notice that the largest Christian denomination in the world was raising the white flag of surrender to the New World Order. And whether they realize it or not, anyone who's fighting against the Great Reset today, the New World Order, is in fact fighting against the very same anti-Christian factions that my father founded this newspaper. Remnant TV is an offshoot of the Remnant newspaper. Subscribe if you haven't done so already. The reason he founded that newspaper was to fight against the same people that a lot of conservatives today now are waking up to and going, oh my gosh, something's really wrong. We got to go after these people. They're destroying our country. So you see what I mean when I say places, people like Fox News, Nighttime Crew, they finally caught up to us. We're not taking our cue from them. We're just thrilled to see that they see the enemy now. Do they see the enemy fundamentally enough as a spiritual war? Maybe, maybe not. But they do see the enemy, and they are targeting that enemy. And that, friends, is good news. We need allies today, all that we can get. If you unite the clans and stand strong and publicly against them, progress can be made against these infernal builders of the New World Order. Because you know why? They came into our churches when I was a boy. They came into Catholic churches first. They ransacked those churches. They trashed those churches. They trashed the sanctuaries. They tore out the communion rails. They bulldozed the altar. They got rid of the mass. They got rid of the priests. They got rid of the nuns. You see? And what did traditional Catholics do then? I'm talking 50, 60, 70 years ago. What did we do? Not me, but what did the pioneers of this movement do? They dug in. They fought back. They didn't say, oh, we can't win. It's the end of the world. The devil's just going to win anyway, so all we can do is pray. They fought back. They dug in. And they preserved the faith of our fathers. They preserved the way of life for our children to the point now where in countries like France, traditional Catholicism is the future of the church. The old Latin Mass that I keep talking about? It's alive and well. They buried it in 1969. It was done. It was illegal. Couldn't use it anymore. Only renegades were using that old liturgy back then. Today, it's celebrated all over the world in every major city in this country. How did that happen? Because people stayed on the field and they fought for it. Because they didn't get discouraged. They didn't give up. And the enemies, because they're the same people that that trashed the Catholic Church and now building the new order, same people, they lost that round. The Catholics, our traditional Catholics, are here to stay. We're fighting harder than ever, and we're organized now because we've been at it for 50 years. We won that round. And yes, now there is so much more to do than just that. We need to make sure that Pope Francis, for example, that he cannot hand us over to the builders of the New World Order. Right now, he's talking to the globalists all by himself out there. He has no backup from us. The Catholic faith, Catholic Church, most people now are waking up to this guy.
John Kerry has been meeting with government officials and business leaders ahead of the United Nations Climate Change Conference due to take place in Glasgow later this year. The former U.S. Secretary of State spoke to Vatican media after his meeting with the Pope, and when asked why he came to visit Pope Francis, he said that he believed when it came to the climate crisis, Pope Francis is one of the great voices on the subject.
We are not going to go along with him, which is what he was put in place to do, hand the Catholics over to the New World Order. So yeah, we are declaring a political war against resets and climate change, dictatorships, the whole thing. We are proclaiming the kingship of Jesus Christ against the friends of Francis who would enslave the entire planet if we let them. And we will not let them. And guess what? If we stay on God's side, we're going to be victorious, not them. Now, you can join us if you want, or you can shoot us in the back because we're just too positive and too political. But we are going to walk out onto that field. We're doing it right now. We do it every day. We're going onto that battlefield. We're united with all sorts of able-bodied fighters, not necessarily Catholic, who like us are no angels, but they share our common foe. And as such, they're our friends and allies. Friends, for God's sake, for the sake of your children, please ignore the naysayers out there who say we can't win. It's the end of the world. Give up the fight. Just pray. We don't know that it's the end of the world. We don't know what's going on. Our job as soldiers of Christ is to believe, pray, and fight. Fight as soldiers must. Look for the opportunities. Scan that horizon for the allies that God will surely send to us. Do not lose hope. Be confident in the coming victory. Because God wins in the end. Stay with Him, and you'll stay with us. You'll stay with your family until one of us, please God, sooner than later, plants the cross of Christ in the heart of this diabolical New World Order. It's going to happen, friends. It's just a matter of time. keep the faith, keep hope alive, never surrender, never back down. We're together in this. I'm Michael Matt for Remnant TV. Thank you so much for listening. God bless you, and we'll see you next week.